Philippine Senator Riz Ontiveros urges the Foreign Affairs Department to help secure an interview with a self-confessed Chinese spy detained in Thailand. Ontiveros wants to get more details of allegations made by Xi Jiang in an Al Jazeera documentary that former Philippine town mayor Alice Goh is a Chinese spy. The senator says contact with Xi was lost after he was transferred to another prison facility in Thailand. He was imprisoned on charges of illegally operating a casino. The DFA has said it is exhausting all diplomatic and legal channels to communicate with Xi. The Philippine Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission says it will file a supplemental complaint against former Duterte administration spokesman Harry Roque. The commission's spokesperson says the complaint is connected to qualified human trafficking cases against offshore gaming operator Lucky South 99. Roque is the subject of a police manhunt after evading a house order to arrest him for contempt. The manhunt has been expanded to Mindanao, where Roque was reportedly cited in September. He was cited in contempt for failing to submit documents to the House Quad Committee probing illegal offshore gaming operations. The lawyers and alleged coddlers of detained Pastor Apollo Quiboloy facing sedition charges filed by the police. The PNP says the complaints stemmed from the overwhelming resistance they faced during their search for Quiboloy. Among those charged are Kingdom of Jesus Christ legal counsel attorney Israelito Torreon and former SMNI host Lorraine Badoy.
Mga inalleged namin doon, ang kanilang mga ginawa, like calling on the people to rise against the government, to prevent the police from serving the warrant of arrest, and many others. So yan ay lalabas naman sa pag nagtumakbo na ang pag-iimbestiga ng DOJ.
Torreon says they are ready to respond to the allegations.
Ang answer ko lang dyan, tatag lang. No? I would like to commend General Torre for his audacity in filing cases against me and the respondents. We will craft a very excellent counter affidavit and I will leave everything to the Lord Almighty.
The police deployed at least 3,000 of its officers in search of the preacher in his 30-hectare compound in Davao. The PNP is also preparing additional charges of obstruction of justice against those who tried to conceal Quiboloy's whereabouts prior to his arrest. Police, however, are coy on whether Vice President Sara Duterte is included in the complaint. Duterte had said Quiboloy was no longer in Davao City when she visited the KOJC compound during the police operations.
Hintayin po natin kung ano po yung ilalaman po ng complaint. I don't want to preempt po yung isasampang kaso po ng CADG.
Meanwhile, the pre-marking of evidence for Quiboloy's qualified human trafficking case at the Pasig Regional Trial Court was concluded Thursday afternoon. The request for Quiboloy's house or hospital arrest was denied by the court. Six staff members in the office of Vice President Sara Duterte are subpoenaed by a House panel to an inquiry on how she spent her confidential funds. As Vivian Gulia tells us, lawmakers want an explanation as to why millions were spent for the rental of alleged safe houses.
The monthly rent for this unit at a high-end building in Taguig City is 90,000 pesos. While the fee for staying at this luxury resort is 25,000 pesos a night. But according to House Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability Chairperson, Representative Joel Chua, the office of Vice President Sara Duterte paid way more when she supposedly rented safe houses using her confidential funds in 2022. Based on the accomplishment report it submitted to the Commission on Audit, 16 million pesos were paid for 11 days. 34 acknowledgement receipts were submitted to COA for the period, with expenses ranging from 250,000 pesos to 1 million pesos.
Hindi po ba kayo nagtaka na sobrang mahal noon? 90,000 a day as compared po dun sa luxury resort. with complete amenities. Much worse, kung 4 days. Yung 1 million, 250,000 per day.
Mr. Chair, we do not have information on the safe houses.
The Commission on Audit admits they have no way to validate the property or the owners of the rented safe houses.
You do not determine whether it's reasonable or true.
Since it is compliance, we often do not.
Manila First District Representative Ernesto Jonicio Jr. also asked why the confidential expenses for the same item remained at 16 million pesos in the first and second quarters of 2023, even when the period covered is longer.
Being an attorney and 2 years in the audit department of the Commission on Audit, hindi po, regular po ba yung ganon, na same amount but different number of days?
Well, personally po, medyo steep nga po yung, sa, lalo na po yung sa 2022 since 11 days lang po siya.
Similar to the last hearing, neither VP Duterte nor the 6 invited officers from her office appeared before the panel on Thursday, prompting the committee to issue a subpoena and order the issuance of an immigration lookout bulletin against the 6 officers. In a position paper the OVP officer submitted to the House panel, they said the hearing is unnecessary and that their attendance is not needed, noting that government offices like the OVP are regularly audited by the Commission on Audit. They also claimed that the subject matter of the House Committee deliberation is not in aid of legislation and questioned the jurisdiction of the panel to conduct the inquiry.
Ang Kongreso ang guardian of public funds. Ang investigasyon ng government transaction is a proper exercise of the power of inquiry. It also follows that non-compliance and unjustified, baseless refusal with congressional inquiries is tantamount to a violation of the Constitution.
The answer is yes.
Lawmakers also questioned the previously Duterte-led Department of Education's use of certifications from the Armed Forces of the Philippines to justify the 15.54 billion pesos confidential fund expenses.
Now, all the officers from the AFP, that includes General Memfin, the USEC for Administration, are stating that the DepEd did not utilize any of its confidential fund in support of the Youth Leadership Summit. These statements, Mr. Chair, are completely contradictory to what DepEd has made the COA believe.
Alam ko rin na ginagamit nyo lang yun para i-justify yung expenditure nyo ng confidential fund ng Department of Education. Di ba? You just use that to justify your liquidation.
Ang participation ko po ay naganap nung ako po ay OIC for finance kasi at that time, nung na-receive namin yung AOM. And we had to respond to the AOM.
Meanwhile, another DepEd official claimed he had received envelopes with cash during Duterte's stint as education chief. DepEd Director Resty Osha said the envelopes were handed to him by the same assistant secretary that also gave envelopes to former Education Undersecretary Gloria Mercado.
The very first time I encountered that matter, sir, was sometime in April of 2023. I was given an envelope and it was later on I found out that there was money in it.
Executive session time.
Also during the hearing, Surigao Sur Representative Johnny Pimentel and former DepEd Undersecretary Epimaco Dencing III had a heated exchange after Pimentel accused Dencing of asking for commission from congressmen for constructing school buildings, which the latter denied.
Gusto mo mag-executive session tayo, ipapakita ko sa iyo mga congressmen.
Sige, wala akong nakausap. Yung sa Manila nyo, I was never with the architect Texon.
Order please. One minute suspension.
The committee temporarily suspended the hearing. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Now, the Philippine Poll Body has received 246 petitions challenging the candidacies of political aspirants running for the 2025 midterm polls. Of these, 104 are petitions to declare nuisance candidates for local positions, while 24 seek to cancel or deny due course to certificates of candidacies. COMELEC's initial list for the 2025 senatorial race includes 66 candidates, among them Pastor Apollo Kibuloy, who faces charges of child abuse and human trafficking. The poll body says it uses criteria such as public service, inclination, political ideas, and platforms in determining nuisance candidates.
Kung sila po ay madedeklarang nuisance candidate dahil nga po doon sa ating walang intention talaga na maayos, magdudulot ng makiri ng elections, eh ang mangyayari po dyan, matatanggal na silang tuluyan sa listahan. May karapatan pa po silang tumakbo sa Supreme Court at mag-file kung sakaling gusto nila. Pero kailangan po sa loob ng 5 araw ng pagkakalabas ng desisyon ng Commission and Bank ay makakuha sila ng temporary restraining order. Otherwise po, talagang i-implement na po namin ito.
The number of Filipinos who have returned from conflict-hit Lebanon climbs to over 500. The latest group of 47 repatriates arrived Thursday via Kuwait Airways flight. They are set to receive 170,000 pesos financial assistance from the government. Authorities say some Filipinos have chosen to stay in Lebanon for personal reasons despite the escalating conflict. The government vows to continue monitoring the situation and provide assistance, while plans for a mandatory evacuation are still under review.
We're waiting for the ambassador's recommendation. One, if there is no more functioning government locally. The other is if the situation is already such that there is total risk to life.
We're making our services more available. We have hotlines. We have transport even, no, doon sa mga nangangailangan na maidala sa mga shelters. May mga roving teams tayo.
Let's get an update on the weather now from Pagasa forecaster Ana Clauren Horda. Good morning, Ana.
Yes, good morning, Bettina. The Intertropical Convergence Zone, or ITCZ, is now affecting Mindanao, and this will bring cloudy skies with scattered rains and thunderstorms over Zamboanga Peninsula, Sucsayan, Bangsamoro, Davao Occidental, Davao Oriental, and Davao del Sur. Here in Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting a generally fair weather condition aside from isolated rain showers mostly in the afternoon or in the evening. Currently, we are monitoring a low pressure area and was estimated at around 2,040 kilometers east of Eastern Visayas. And this LPA has a low chance to develop into a tropical depression within the next 24 hours, but we're still monitoring this LPA because of by next week this LPA may develop into a tropical depression. That's why we advise the public to continue monitoring for the updates. And currently we don't have any gale warning raised in any seabirds of the country. And over the weekend here in Metro Manila, we're expecting a fair weather condition aside from isolated rain showers and mostly in the afternoon or in the evening. And that's the latest from Pag-asa. This is Ana Clauren Horda. Good morning.
All right. Thank you very much for that update, Ana. Have a great weekend.